Hi, good morning, and welcome to Kāpiti Impact Church, to our online service this morning. A big welcome to you if you're joining with us live on a Sunday morning, or perhaps you're catching up during the week on YouTube. Big welcome. I hope you enjoy what's to come. I hope you engage with God and get into His presence as we learn about Him, as we worship, as we take this time to meet together. Meeting together is great, isn't it, Johanna?
It is. Welcome to our kitchen. Last week we really enjoyed spending some time with Glenn and Debbie Mattingly. They came over for breakfast, brunch, and a bit of church, which is a really, really good hangout time. We've really missed the company of our nearest and dearest, so it was awesome to have them in our home, eat together, tune in together, and listen to the message that was shared by Shane Willard. This week we have been really, really relieved is probably a good word, to have a few more freedoms locally. I know that school and daycare are back for a lot of parents, which is great for parents and kids alike. But we've also really enjoyed catching up with a few friends and also getting into our local playgrounds.
Yeah, the one thing I've struggled with is it's taken a week, so I had to book a week in advance to get a haircut, which is not normal for me. Normally I head down on a Saturday and sit down in the chair. I'm there in the chair in about half an hour. But I've had to book. There's been so many people feeling a bit woolly on it, on the top of the head. But it's probably been a good thing this week because it's been a bit chilly. We've had the fire going for the first time this year, which has been nice and cozy and warm inside. So that's been good. It is good to remember, I think, that even though we are in level two with some of our freedoms constricted, that we still are in a good place. We're probably in the most freest time in history. One of the freest places in history, and just to remember that there are others around the world who don't have the same freedoms of us, even without a global pandemic going on, that we still do live in an amazing free place. We're free to worship God, we're free to meet together most of the time, not right now, but most of the time. We are definitely hashtag blessed, and it does pay to remember that and be grateful for that.
Just a reminder to use the chat function down the sidebar there if you would like to talk with other members of the congregation. We will be there. And also, if you have a specific prayer request, there is a prayer request button as well, and we can get in touch with you and then see what we can do to help.
Yeah, and after the service, we have a Zoom meeting, just a catch-up, kind of like a morning tea. You can come in there, bring your drinks and your biscuits and have a bit of a chat after the service, maybe dissect Lawrence's message or just catch up with people and say hi. It's a really good time. So without further ado, we'll move on to Philippa.
The last Ignite competition, the selfie competition. The winners are the Collings kids for their super sibling selfie and for the laughable lemonade Lila. Congratulations, guys. I will deliver your prize to you soon.
Thanks for that, guys. So for those of you who maybe are living under a rock, haven't really heard, we are very pregnant at the moment. In fact, it's just 3 weeks till our little girl joins us. And I just been thinking about that, and we know that when she comes, we love her already, but when she comes and emerges into this world, there's going to be just an increase in that love for her. But we know that when she comes into the world, there's limitations on her. She physically won't be able to do too much. Mentally, she'll still be growing. And obviously, what we understand and what I understand about God is that he fills us with so much potential. So we'll get this little baby, this little cute newborn. But we know that within her already, there is this potential for so much more. And we think about God. And for me, my understanding of God is that he doesn't, it's not in his nature just to plonk something fully formed into the middle of creation and to let it go. But God's nature seems to be, from what I read from the Genesis story even, from where he says, you know, let the land produce vegetation and produce the trees and produce the plants, and let the sea produce the swimming creatures, and let the land produce animals of all types. God, he forms something and he creates in it this bunch of potential. And it's in his nature to create that and then partner with it to see it reach its full potential. And I think that's really encouraging for us. You know, Jesus talks about it. He talks about the mustard seed. And so we have this little seed that is full and packed with everything it needs to become one of the biggest trees in the world. But it starts with that little seed. And within that is that potential. And you put it in the right environment and it grows and it grows and it has this amazing potential come out. And when it partners with God and is in the right environment. And so I just want to encourage you today that God is full of potential. He's full of potential for you and full of potential for this world, for his creation, that he hasn't fully formed you yet, that he looks at you and he sees that potential packed inside you. He sees that potential in the newborn to become maybe a world leader or a sports star or whatever it happens to be in the future. But God has loaded each one of us with his potential. And it's up to us to put ourselves in the right environment and to partner with God and say, God, I want to see that full potential that you put in me released so that I can be all you've called me to be. So what I want you to do is also take this opportunity to realize that not only within us and within creation is there potential, but in every moment there's potential for God to be glorified. In every situation you come into, there is potential to look and see what's the potential here for God to be glorified. And as we come now to a time of singing, a time of worship, I just want to take this opportunity that as Tim and the team lead us in some songs, that there is an opportunity and a potential to worship God and to glorify him. So let's step into that moment and let's say, God, I want to live and see this full potential come to being as we worship God this morning.
Our God, you are invincible, the stronghold Tuhia, ki te rangi. Tuhia, ki te whenua. Tuhia, ki te nākou. O ngā tangata katoa, there is but one love, and it is your love. Ko te me nui, ko te aroha. Tuhia,
chasing us down, and it's restoring our land. And God, that's our prayer, that your love would be evident in this time, that it would be tangible to our souls, and that it would free us from the darkness. We sing, your love has freed us.
Your love has freed us. We're free indeed. Spoken to our pain, revealing hope. Your love has freed us, and we're free indeed. Spoken to our pain, revealing hope again. Love. Your love has freed us, and we're free indeed. Spoken to our pain, revealing hope again. Your love has freed us. Spoken to our pain, revealing hope again.
Let's lift it up, your love.
Cause your love has freed us. We're free indeed. Spoken to our pain, revealing hope again. Your love has freed us. We're free indeed. Spoken to our pain. Ko te me nui.
Surprise! Doing things a little bit differently this week. Oh my gosh. I know. Who would have thought? I mean, it's not like we've done things differently for the last 6-7 weeks or anything, but you know, this week is a new week and we're going to do something different again.
Ata Marie, good to see you. Awesome. Welcome to our TV room. And you're going to get...
That's ironic.
This is the first time. This is the first time that you... probably will have seen in this kind of format. It's the first time we've ever done it, where we just chat and you get to hear a bit of our heart, and that's the goal for this.
So we were talking with some friends recently about how we see Kāpiti Impact Church, and a crucial part of Kāpiti Impact that we see is being people that have big hearts. And Kāpiti Impact has been a great place of people with big hearts, and we just wanted to talk about that some more this morning and talk about the realities of that.
Yeah, it's been a topic, you know, heart condition and our heart being, you know, in terms of a biblical understanding, the center of who you are and your identity, and that heart is so much part of the scriptural story and the condition of people's hearts. For me, one of the key verses we first used was out of 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 29. And it says there of Solomon, and God gave Solomon exceedingly great understanding and wisdom and largeness of heart as the sand of the seashore. And I remember early on in my office, I had that verse, except I substituted Solomon's name out and put Lawrence in there. Because my desire has always been to have a big heart, to be a wise person, but also to have a heart that was huge, because that was what God had done in me. And so that's been an important part of who we are as a church, and who we are, who we've endeavored to be as a couple as well. The other passage that is quite a foundational one to this is Proverbs 4:23, which says there, above all else, guard your heart, for it affects everything you do, or for out of it flows the issues of life. So it just puts heart and our heart condition right at the priority of wisdom and living with wisdom and the journey that God has called us to live out. So it's what we want to talk about.
And so like in Kings, where it says a heart as large as the sands of the seashore, and guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. There's a lot of sand on the seashore, and when there's a spring, like Pew Pew Springs down south, it's beautiful and it's fresh and it's invigorating. And when we guard our hearts, because our heart is the wellspring of life, there's an ability of overflow and invigorating that can come through that.
I think for us, you know, we've talked this year about some of our values and you know, underpinned on the foundation of loving God and loving people, and realizing that love can only come out of our hearts. It's not something you can create. It's not something you can force. You know, love isn't a forced thing. It's just something that you allow to flow. And I know in devotions a couple of weeks ago, we were talking about the woman at the well, and Jesus says to her, if you drink of the water that I'll give you, you'll never thirst again. And out of your heart will flow a river of living water. And so I guess for me and for us, our desire is building a church that has individuals, but also together as a community, we have this flow of life that comes from the heart of who we are. It's not something we force, it's something we allow God to birth and to generate from us.
So why? Why should we be people of big heart? People of big heart
people that carry the kingdom of God well. People of big heart are people who can impart into others' lives. People of big heart are not people that are shriveled and walking in a shrunken form of themselves, but are instead people that are walking in the fullness of who God has called them to be. They're walking in freedom every day. They're walking their journey of life at its fullest level. Jesus said he came to give us life in full. People of big heart are people who are every day realizing more and more of what that life to the full looks like.
Mm. Yeah, I think it's a challenging comment to live as big-hearted people. I think it's a challenge for us to do that. When you live with big-heartedness, the risks of that are also increased. The more you increase your heart, the more there is for hurt, for woundedness to come in. And so the importance of guarding your heart, you know, and protecting it, but also keeping the internal part of us pure and clear of offense, clear of hurt, clear of woundedness. And that's a huge challenge, I think. And I think that's part of the journey of big-heartedness, is there are some risks associated with it. You have to have a level of humility about that.
Yeah.
That I need to be open to learning and continuing to be a lifelong learner if I want to be wise of exceedingly great understanding, as Solomon was, but also to have largeness of heart. And it's challenging. Yeah. That's a simple word for it.
Yeah. So, I mean, Lawrence just said, what does it look like to have a large heart? And that's to say sorry. It's to forgive others. Character traits that he calls us to rise ourselves and our spirits, to lift ourselves, I guess, into a place of saying, actually, I'm not going to live in a place of bitterness or grudges or unforgiveness. Instead, I'm going to choose to forgive. I'm going to choose to have a big heart again. I'm going to choose to keep the well clean and clear in order to allow the wellspring to be pure and fresh, because then we walk in a way that is God-honoring and life-giving.
Mm. Every time we talk about this, I see the picture of, you know, the rock pools that you go down, and particularly somewhere down at Pukerua Bay. And I remember on trips taking the girls down there when we were young, and we'd hang out in the rock pools and look at all the stuff. And there's the anemones that are always there, and they're sitting open like this. And then when something invades their space, which often it was fun the first time to show your kids, look what happens when you poke it. And you poke the anemone and it goes, and it shrivels,
yeah.
You know, and then you wait for it, and it slowly, very slowly opens its way back up again. And I love that picture of what often happens in our hearts is allowing God to open our hearts, allowing our trust in him to grow to a point where we're actually opening our hearts to him and to people. But then stuff happens, and our instinctive response is to draw back into ourselves and protect ourselves. And part of the journey, I guess, of allowing God to grow bigger within us and our relationship with him to deepen, is that our resilience increases. And you know, we make choices every day to live with a large heart. We all need to do that. But at the same time, it's not something that is, you know, we can force. It's not something that we can create out of our own strength. It's something that God does.
So the ultimate of how a big-hearted person looks is Jesus. He was the biggest-hearted person ever to walk on the face of the earth. And he is why we are inspired to walk like him. And I think of a story that I read about recently, and I shared about in Devos a while back, just in relation to the fact that the day Jesus found out his closest friend, cousin, the person who really understood him and knew what he was about, John the Baptist, the day he was beheaded and killed, Jesus went for a walk to not only get away, but also to kind of process everything that was going on. And thousands of people followed the disciples in order to get some of what Jesus had, and they were all about themselves and taking. They weren't going, "Jesus, how are you? I'm so sorry you lost John the Baptist." And yet he put aside himself at that time, and he had a big enough heart to say, "I'm going to minister God to these people, the Father heart of God to these people. I'm going to bring healing into their lives. I'm going to bring freedom into their lives. And because I have a deep and close connection with my Father, I know that I can go and draw from that well later. I know that my big heart is something that I can give no matter what season or what I'm facing," because he was facing a horrible situation, but he still had the Father God heart within him that he was able to give. And I think that's not only something for us to think about and meditate on and aspire to, not in the sense of driving ourselves, but in the sense of, are we going to the Father heart of God, and are we taking what we need to have big hearts from the Father heart, so that then we have something to give, so that we have a big heart to pass on.
It always brings us back to our relationship with Jesus, and our ability to allow the Holy Spirit to give us what we need, to be aware of what we have in the Holy Spirit already, because he resides in us when we choose to follow Jesus. God himself, the creator of the heavens and the earth, comes and chooses to live in us. And so we have everything we need to be able to live as big-hearted people, to be able to live the way that God has called us to live. But it keeps coming back to the challenge of, are we building and are we strengthening and are we deepening our relationship with Jesus? And what does that look like for you? What does it look like for me? What does it look like for us? It's a journey that we're on. It's a journey of deepening that connection with God and our vulnerability with him, and allowing him to speak into our hearts so that our largeness grows. And that's different for different people, but it always, for me, it always comes back to that relationship with God. And what does that look like for you? What does it look like for me? Jesus, as Philippa was referring to that story, Jesus made it part of his rhythm and his ritual and his routine to spend quality, consistent time with his Father. And that was even when he was fully divine and fully human at the same time. So how much more do we need that connection to be big-hearted people?
I was really inspired this week by a couple of things. One circumstance when I was really struggling personally, and somebody that I love came alongside me and was like Jesus to me. And they took a moment to put themselves aside and they enlarged their hearts in order to minister to mine. And that is a really big deal when you're somebody in any circumstance, if somebody around you chooses to enlarge their hearts for the sake of another, that is bringing the kingdom of God into a situation. That is expanding the kingdom. And that is what God has called us to do. He's called us to bring the kingdom. And it's easy to talk about bringing the kingdom, but to actually act it out and to actually bring the kingdom is another thing entirely. What does it look like to bring the kingdom? Bringing the kingdom is a kind word. Bringing the kingdom is not gossiping about another person. Bringing the kingdom is being loving in a situation where you otherwise might not actually want to be. Bringing the kingdom is praying for another person in a situation. Bringing the kingdom is asking for healing for somebody. But all of those things, every time we choose
choose to lay ourselves down and bring the kingdom, then we are allowing our hearts to be enlarged by God. Because going and drawing from the well that Jesus and the Father and the Holy Spirit give us, that gives us the strength and the reserves and the reservoir to be able to say, okay, I can allow my heart to be enlarged so that I can bring the kingdom. But we actually have to make that decision as well. Like I talked about last week, kids, when we put on our cardigan, when we put on something, we're choosing, we're making a decision, and then we're doing. And it's the same with our hearts. We can make the choice to allow our hearts to be enlarged, or we can make the choices and the thought patterns that allow our hearts to be shrunk and made smaller. I can make a choice to bring life in a situation and freedom and wisdom, or I can be in a situation and I could just say nothing. Or we can choose with our actions, with our words, with what we do when we're around others. That is how we can choose to enlarge our hearts and therefore enlarge the hearts of others and enlarge the kingdom in the process. It's like this ongoing effect of a circle, a spiral that just gets bigger and bigger and bigger every time we go to it, every time we look at it, every time we allow ourselves. There's like this little heart, tiny wee heart that was mine, and then God grows it a little bit bigger, and then somebody else puts something into my life that makes it a little bit bigger, and then somebody else does something and it makes it a little bit bigger. And God and the people he's placed around us help our hearts to grow, and every choice we make helps our hearts to grow. So our challenge is this week, as we're living, breathing, moving, life is hard sometimes. But are we allowing ourselves to grow? Are we allowing our hearts to be enlarged and to be people that are big-hearted? Are we drawing from the well that is Jesus to be able to allow our hearts to grow and flourish and be full of life and freedom?
Yeah. May God give us his grace and his Spirit's unction to be able to make that happen, to be able to allow him to enlarge our hearts, because we want to be people with big hearts. And so may you experience that this week. Grace and peace.
Well, church, that's it from us. Thank you so much for joining us. It's really good for us to spend time together. Don't forget to tune in if you would like to chat some more over that Zoom meeting that is happening straight after the service here. Bring your cup of coffee and your biscuit. We've been really excited by some of the awesome good news that we've seen happening all around the world. We've really enjoyed a YouTube program by John Krasinski, who's from The Office, where he's been gathering clips from all around of wonderful things that have been happening within the country during lockdown.
Yeah, within America. So give it a look on YouTube. Anyway, go well this week. We'll just going to finish off with a prayer. And then, yeah, you're welcome to join us for a bit of morning tea in the Zoom. God, we thank you that your goodness is good. Lord, all the time you are good. And Lord, I pray this week we would increase in our knowledge of you, Lord, and in our gratefulness for this place that you put us at this time and place in history. Lord, I pray that you would just bless, Lord, every family involved with KIC, Lord, in our community, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Enjoy the celebration. See you next time. Celebrate, celebrate.